My name is Jeff Hemingway. I'm a state soil quality specialist with NRCS. We're going to go through and talk about a number of different characteristics today that we have to do with soil quality. We're going to use our rainfall simulator to do just that. First of all, the rainfall simulator is built to do just this. Put on about 1.5 to 2 inches of water on simulated soil conditions so that we can look at different parameters. Infiltration, runoff, raindrop detachment, aggregate stability. We'll be talking about each one of those independently, but we'll be trying to define those more and explaining that further. But first of all, let's explain just this, is that the rainfall simulator has several different vegetation conditions, land use conditions, if you want to go at that. The first one over here is a pasture. It's was cut out of my pasture this morning. It's basically a loam soil that is in the bluegrass and a brome grass sod. The next one is a no-till soil, actually, in the adjacent field. So it's still my same field. 2 months ago, I seeded that down to a cover crop, and you can actually see that here. The no-till field that we were talking about with residue, this is wheat residue. No-till field without residue. And then my neighbor's conventionally tilled field. What we're actually going to be looking at is the runoff associated coming off the rainfall simulator, and that's depicted. It'll actually show up in the front set of jars here. And then if you can actually see that behind here, we actually had another set of jars. And that second set of jars will actually capture the infiltrated water. That is the water that's moving through the soil as we go through the demonstration. So with that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start the rainfall simulator, and we're going to start to talk a little bit more about some of those characteristics. Okay, one of the first things I like to talk about is some of the first things that we're going to see. And raindrop impact on the soil surface is extremely important. We've got, during a rain event, we've got that raindrop hitting the soil surface, detaching that soil. It has a lot of kinetic energy. We don't really understand that very well, I don't think. And we don't see that very much because we don't typically stand out in the rain and watch it. But as the example here is, if you see that we have a soil that's covered versus a soil that's not covered, and when I say covered, it actually can even have surface residues, or it can have a crop canopy on it that's protecting that soil. If it's not protected, that raindrop actually hits the soil surface, goes through a process of detachment, and then that soil particle goes into transport, what we call transport, and it's moved and deposited either locally or off-site. We've got a depiction of that raindrop hitting the soil surface right here. It's blown up many times. It looks like a very small explosion. The raindrop hits the soil surface. Again, those raindrops bounce up into the air. And you can actually see that on the rainfall simulator right over here. On the back, you can actually see those soil particles actually have been detached and they're bouncing up. And at some point, almost immediately, one of the first things that I'd like to point out was just this. So we've got a conventionally tilled soil on the far right. Which one actually started runoff event first? The conventionally tilled one. Okay, why was that? Well, you know, we've been taught, I think, through our educational process that if we go out and till a soil, that's beneficial. Well, let's talk some more about that. Infiltration is actually that process of water moving through the soil. It has to be maintained if we're going to continue to move water into the soil. And if we end up with that raindrop hitting the soil surface, we not only end up with that erosion process starting, but we also end up with what? We end up with those soil particles actually being detached, reoriented on the soil surface, and actually plugging the soil matrix, the pores, the macropores, and what happens? We end up with runoff. It's a fairly simple thing to understand. And we can actually see it being depicted here very quickly. Now, what happens in those other conditions? If we have something that's interfering, something that's in the way, that's absorbing that kinetic energy of that raindrop, then that energy is not expressed on the soil surface. We don't end up with that detachment of the soil particle. And we end up with infiltration actually being maintained over time. Any individual that talks about residue as being extremely important really understands this process. And you can't overemphasize that just the impacts of residue itself. Residue on the soil surface or a crop canopy absorbs that energy and maintains that infiltration. Water continues to move down through that soil profile, right? Now, one of the things that I like to really talk a little bit about is soils are made up of pore space. In some cases, it might be half of the profile that we're actually talking about actually might be pore space that is either air or and or water. The other that we typically think about is either mineral material and or organic material. What we don't think about very much is that additional organic material that's in there that's actually living. Soils are full of life. They have bacterial, fungal, root systems from the plants we typically think about, but that life interacts and actually produces, that interaction produces a variety of products associated. One of those that we do understand a little bit about is another depiction I have here of a stained mycorrhizal fungi. That is the residual of mycorrhizal fungi called glomalin. It's a glycoprotein. That glycoprotein actually shows up brown in soils. It's actually stained green here. That was actually discovered by Sarah Wright with ARS in 1996. So when we start really looking at those characteristics, we need to understand that they have major impacts on the soil surface. Now, the other thing that I guess I really like to point out is just this. What are you actually seeing here, right? We end up with quite a bit of runoff actually occurring from our conventionally tilled and our no-till. The no-till with the residue versus without the residue. You see the impact of residue? Same soil. No joke today. The difference there is having residue on the soil surface. You see the jar in the back is actually where infiltrated water, our cover crop, and our piece of sod. Now, the color of the water going through the sod today is basically, I think, just because I cut it out today. But continue to notice what that runoff event actually looks like. After you've gone through this class and you've talked a little bit more about runoff and water quality associated, we know that as we run off and that soil particle actually is moved off site, what impact does that have on surface waters? Well, sediment is a pollutant itself, but it also has what? Nutrients and or pesticides that we've applied as crop protectant products on that soil moved into our surface waters, right? So from an erosion standpoint, we're not only just concerned about the impacts on the soil itself, the erosion, the loss, but what about the water quality, also other aspects? I'd like to show you a little short demonstration on aggregate stability. I've got a conventionally tilled and a no-till clod, and we'll just drop them in here. My no-till clod, conventionally tilled clod. And what I wanted to show is immediately, is I don't know if you can see that, but here's my no-till clod, and here's my conventionally tilled clod, but you can see that because it has really poor aggregate stability, it's starting to degrade once it's immersed almost immediately. See that? Where the no-till clod, which has high aggregate stability, high organic matter, is holding together better than that one. See that? How clear that water is comparatively? This is a really simple little test. You know, when I go out and try to collect soil for a rainfall simulator, this is what I do. It's a really simple thing to do. Well, I want to find something that has low aggregate stability. I just pour some water in a jar and throw in a clod. Go for it. This is my no-till tray, right? My wind out of your day is not being helpful. This is the runoff. So is that tray actually wet? Dry? We put on how much water? About an inch and a quarter on. Well, let's flip it over. Wet to the bottom, right? Conventionally tilled. That one went to the bottom too. Still dry on the bottom. I think this is a really good demonstration from my standpoint because it really, with most producers anyway, they've been taught to believe that if we increase the amount of tillage, we increase the infiltration rates. And that's just not the truth. What happens in conventionally tilled is we dry out that surface, but what about subsequent rain events? What about the reactivity of the soils? No-till, we typically talk about macro pore development, those major pores, good soil structure, aggregate stability. Conventionally tilled, we're actually oxidizing that organic material. In other words, we're reducing the amount of organic matter within those soils, and subsequently we affect aggregate stability and infiltration rates.